Acknowledging and honoring our pain for the world is, I think, the most distinctive feature of the work that reconnects, and the most important, too. We also call that kind of work despair work. And these two terms, our pain for the world and despair, in our usage of them, includes the same ingredients, our responses to a world in crisis, a world of suffering. And these ingredients include grief, oh, such sorrow. They include fear, terror for what will happen to ourselves and our near and dear, anger and outrage over the actions and motives that have brought this to pass, guilt over our complicity with destructive forces, sense of futility, powerlessness, overwhelm, all these feelings in various combinations and intensities are part of our pain for the world. And to learn to face these, to be unblocked by fear of them, is an enormous force for liberation for us. And when we are not afraid of these painful feelings, then nothing can stop us. Now, in working with this, there are many forms listed in the book, much simpler to do than the truth mandala, which you are about to see. There's the open sentences as described in the book for helping us speak and reflect on our pain for the world. There's the forms of milling that you can bring forward. There is people sitting together in simple sharing in twos and threes and foursomes, or even in a whole circle. There are deep responses to what is happening to our world. Now, as you lead these processes, there are three things I want you to remember. Three things about this pain. One is that it's universal. Everybody feels it, regardless of their party affiliation, their rank or power in this world, whether they work for the Pentagon or the peace movement. They sense this radical uncertainty about whether life will go on. And that's new under the sun, which is the second thing I want you to remember, that this pain or anguish is unprecedented. You know, our ancestors throughout the millennia faced many hardships, war, plague, famine, as well as sickness, old age, and death. But always, more or less, there was the assumption that life would go on this planet, that the work of our hands and heads and hearts would continue on into future generations. And that is what is lost now, that certainty. I think that loss is the pivotal psychological reality of our time. And the third thing to remember is that we tend to block it. Maybe because it's so huge. Maybe because we feel that to really open ourselves to the pain we carry would mire us in it, sink us into despair, render us incapable of continuing with our jobs and our families and our communities. This repression is widespread. So I want you to look in chapter 2 of Coming Back to Life to review with me there the many causes for the avoidance and suppression of our pain for the world. These are important to address because what it amounts to is, in many cases, a suppression of the instinct for the preservation of life. To suppress these strong emotions renders us obedient, passive, acquiescing in preparations for our own bondage or demise. The importance of dealing with that is reflected in what Vietnamese Zen master Thich Nhat Hanh said once. His students came to him one day and asked him, "Beloved teacher, Thay," they called him, "what do we most need to do for the healing of our world?" I think they expected him to distinguish between inner work, outer work, working in the system, or getting enlightened on the meditation cushion. And he didn't move in that direction at all, because his answer was, "What we most need to do is to hear within ourselves the sound of the earth crying." Now that's an amazing statement. It assumes that we can hear within ourselves the sounds of the earth crying. And indeed, such is the web of life, such is our embeddedness as open systems in the fabric of existence, we can and we do. We each are aware of what is happening to the air we breathe and the water we drink, and to the people who make our clothes in sweatshops overseas. At some level of our consciousness, that is there, like a silent scream. And he reframes that then, you see, he takes the pain and he calls it the sounds of the earth crying. Well, that reframing is an essential part of the work that reconnects. Often in leading exercises of this nature, I will pause at the end or in the middle and invite people to reflect. "Please notice," I say, "how the concerns that you've been expressing extend beyond your personal ego. Please observe how they go beyond your individual needs and wants," because that says something very important about what you are, who you are. You are capable of suffering with our world. That's good news. It shows that you're not hermetically sealed off. To suffer with. That's the literal meaning of compassion. A central feature in every major spiritual tradition. To be able to suffer with your world. As we show we're fully capable of in these workshops, show that you are a compassionate being. We reframe our pain for the world as compassion. And our pain for the world springs not from some personal craziness or emotional weakness or some fact of our individual biography, but it springs from our interconnectedness with each other and all life. So be sure in this work that you call people's attention to that. And you will see how I do that reframing in the Truth Mandala that just is about to begin. I've put out objects that help people as they hold them speak of the anger, the fear, the grief, the overwhelm and emptiness, deprivation that they feel. And then with each one, I point to the positive side from which they spring, how the grief itself is a manifestation of our love. We wouldn't mourn what we don't love. How our fear demonstrates courage in the speaking of it. How our anger is in essence an outcry of passion for justice. How the emptiness we feel is actually, painful as it is, a place where the new can arise. It makes space for that. So it's good to remember, as we facilitate this work, three things not to do. Don't tell people what they should feel or what you think they feel. To do that is presumptuous and patronizing, and it tends to close them down. It also can tend very often to sentimentalize. A certain tough love in helping people, giving them the opportunity to face up to and speak their fears is really good. So don't get sweet and gushy about it. Secondly, don't judge by outer demeanor. Don't jump to conclusions because they seem unmoved, a stolid face through all of this while people are expressing their pain. You can't tell by a person's behavior or demeanor what they're feeling inside. They may be going through a profound inner transformation in their attitudes and respect for their grief for the world. And don't distract people by overly comforting them. Comfort, you know, can give the signal that their display of grief or emotion is bothering you and you'd like them to stop it. So, you honor it. And you honor it and you know that they'll survive it. And you know, because you know too, that the pain we feel for our world and our love for it are two sides of one coin. They're inseparable. We learn again and again, as I have in this work, that we can trust our pain for the world. It may not be pretty. It may not be what we choose to feel. It may be uncomfortable. But we can trust it because it is of one piece with our love for life. I want you to see, usually I ask people to imagine two lines, but they're actually right here. They're four quadrants. You can see them. And I put an object into each quadrant. And into this quadrant, I put dead leaves. And they represent our sorrow, the grief we all carry, for the suffering we're inflicting on ourselves and each other that we're experiencing, for the enormous losses. Then in this quadrant, we put this stone. And this stone is the fear that we all carry, the dread of what's coming down on us. And you know, this stone is like how our heart feels when we're afraid. It feels contracted and hard.